Hey everybody, Mike Lawson here with CU Broadcast. On the show today, we have NCUA's Vice Chairman Rick Metzger talking about his recent field of membership rule changes. Check it out.
Always.
Hey, you know what? You put out a little bit of news lately about these field of membership changes that you guys are requesting out there. And so a lot of people have read them already, so we won't go over them one by one, but what stemmed these changes? What kind of prompted these changes or just the ideas of them?
Well, a couple of things. This is an issue that I've been looking at since I joined the board about a year ago,
okay.
Or a little more than a year ago.
Yeah.
Back when my day in the Oregon legislature, when I was in the Senate there, I authored bills on field of membership for state charters in
mm-hmm.
Oregon. So it's an area that I've had a lot of background on. And I think what we need to look at and realize that, especially as time moves on, and the way the process works in various states
mm-hmm.
versus the federal government,
yes.
States are always the first one. They're the petri dishes that in all kinds of legislation before the glacial move of Congress ever takes place.
You got that right.
And what you certainly notice in various states, some more than others, is that their charters have become much more progressive as time goes on. And so that distance in some cases between the federal charter and the state charter, that chasm is getting larger in certain areas and certain places.
Mm-hmm.
And so to look at having an equitable playing field, and also, and most importantly, is making sure that American families have the choice of financial services that they want, it's incumbent on us to always look at field of membership. Now, we have two issues here. We have statutory limitations,
mm-hmm.
but we also have agency regulations. The agency regulations are within our purview. So I think it's been an important issue to say, let's look at the rules that we impose upon ourselves, and are they still relevant for credit unions now, especially based in states in which those charters may be significantly more advanced than what we're permitting the federal charters.
Indeed.
And, you know, a credit union, I don't believe, should be disadvantaged from being a state or a federal charter. I think we should try to make that line as narrow as possible,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
so there's not competitive differences that are inherent in one way or the other, and let the credit union choose that not based on the competitive landscape, but based on other factors.
Okay, cool, very cool. And let's take a quick look at a few of these here. I mean, like the first three, and we'll include these in the show notes for people to read, but the first three really seem about kind of expanding the field of membership for credit unions. And can you comment on that, just on the first three real quick, and then we'll get to the other two?
Yeah, well, there's a number of ones that and that I believe are, say, for example, low-hanging fruit. We've had a long-standing process in terms of the agency is that when you move to a community charter, for example,
yeah.
An original a SEG-based credit union can, because they're grandfathered, maintain the members who were previously with that credit union.
Of course, yeah.
But the organization itself, the former SEG, as they have new employees, they cannot join. And so it seems to me that is, you know, not a relevant situation. We had an example, and I'll give you just a concrete example.
Sure, sure.
When I was in Oregon, there was a credit union that a large grocery chain was their primary SEG. They became a community charter. So all those who worked for that grocery chain could still be a member because they already were. But all the other employees that started working for that grocery chain couldn't because they were
exactly.
a community charter. And so I think we can look at is that a proper approach, or should the SEG itself be grandfathered, not just the members at that one point in time?
Good idea.
And I think that would encourage a lot of other charters who might be thinking about the federal charter might mm-hmm. say, you know, this is no longer a disadvantage to be able to do this, and that's beneficial to retain our historic roots, not just our historic
mm-hmm.
members.
And obviously, I think credit unions are quite in favor of these as well, because it obviously promotes growth within their membership. So yeah, I mean, I think they would all be on board with this stuff.
Yeah, I would think so.
Indeed, indeed. And so, like the fourth one I was looking at, it's revising and simplifying the process for determining an area is underserved. Now, can you comment on that real quick? I mean, how does that occur? What's the process there?
Well, there's a number of factors that we look at as to whether it's underserved. And part of the question is whether they're still valid.
Mm-hmm.
We look at, the facilities of different financial institutions. Is that underserved or not?
Mm-hmm.
But that may not be a particularly good measure today in the world of mobile banking and others.
Oh, good point.
Looking at brick and mortar is whether it's being served or not. Mm-hmm. Another example that might be more concrete is, let's say you have a large metropolitan area, right? And if you look at, there's all kinds of financial opportunities for people there. But maybe you have a particular community within that city that is not well served, you know, okay. Low income, or so that the community at large, there's people serving those who are median and high income individuals, but not everybody who happens to live in that geographic area is actually well served. They could be underserved, and so looking at the entire area, you can miss different subsets of the population that are underserved.
Yep.
And so taking a look at those things and making sure that we're properly addressing a true underserved population and a geographical limitation isn't necessarily going to do that.
Exactly. Good point.